And you know, if I wasn't an NBA player, right, or a former NBA player, I don't know where I would have got $2 million to start up my operation.
Come on, man. You heard his voice. You know his name. You know his game. Come on, man. From the Knicks to the Pacers to the Hawks to the Wizards. Come on. Nuggets, the Magic. But when he became a Golden State Warrior, it's when his legacy was built, because he was representing the Baytown business.
No. But come where on. Is he from, no Sway? Where is he from?
Where you from is where you at. He was in the Bay, Heather B. He was in the Bay. We all know he from the Jersey stand
Let's
up.
Get
Jersey
it.
Orange
Let's
Jersey
get it.
Stand up. But I want to say salute to this brother, because he took a chance. He was an outlier. They wanted to demonize the industry because they couldn't control it.
Right.
We the ones who made it the infrastructure, made the industry what it is today. Now you got all kind of lawmakers down. They want to reverse the law so they can invest and they could create generational wealth. That was the scary part. The game was creating generational wealth for people who weren't meant to have it. He saw it 10 years ago, and he been 10 years strong. You know how big that is to keep a business for at least 10 years. I want to say salute to this man. He's changing the stigma. Welcome him to the show. The one and only Al Harrington, ladies and gentlemen. Al Harrington.
What up,
hey,
Al? What up, family?
Dirty Jersey.
Let's go, baby. Come this way.
How you man. Feel about that, Callaway?
Come on, Al. You know the Bay loves you, man. Come on, man.
I was popping my collar. I was popping my collar when you give me that Bay love. I'm sure.
Come on, man. You was up in the Bay. That's probably where you got the idea from to start the Viola business. In the Bay.
Man, that was the first time I smoked, and that shit was so strong that I was like, you know what, weed might not be for me, but I matured and I kept pushing it. Now, you know, I'm rolling up right now. It's 420, man. This is a beautiful day.
My man, I love it, brother. Hey man, it's good to hear your voice, sir. It's good to hear your voice. And so that was the first time you smoked was in the Bay Area?
Was in the Bay, man. Well, we was actually in Phoenix, but, you know, I was playing with the Warriors and, you know, Steven Jackson and BD. We had just got knocked out of the playoffs because we needed the Clippers to beat Denver, and they didn't win. So we knew, you know, last game of the season didn't matter. So they just was like, Al, you smoking tonight. You smoking, bro. We ain't got nothing. There's nothing else going on. And I smoked, and I was so paranoid that night. I was just like, bro, I am never smoking again. But like I said, I've come a long way since then.
Yeah, I bet, man. Now you're getting all the smoke. Shout out to Steven Jackson, okay?
There it is.
I like it. One of the things I like to talk about, and then also I want to tell you that we got Heather B, a nephew, and my bonus nephew on the line. Zaya is on the line. Zay, you there? Zaya, you there?
Yeah, I'm here. What's up, everybody?
What up, Zay?
Hey, what's up? Good morning, nephew. How you doing?
What's up? I'm good. I'm chilling.
Bro,
wait,
that's so
funny.
Zay,
trying to give us the sexy voice, bro? Because Al on the line? Zay, you trying to be cool
because
Al.
Oh, he already blow one of the other.
Right.
Don't do that, Al. Don't do that, Al.
Yo, he's 19 and he's fresh out of class. But the reason why this is so dope, Al and Sway, of course, I appreciate both of you. But Sway, I reached out to Sway about this because my nephew, who is 19, has, you know, his affinity for basketball. He's in school playing basketball and whatnot now in college. But what I appreciate about the youth, Al, and what Sway and I always talk about is that they're forward thinkers now. You know, they think differently. And he had hit me and said, you know, Auntie, do you know anybody in the cannabis industry? Like, I want to learn more about it. Between that and the stock market, he's always just like hitting me up and investments and the cannabis industry. And I reached out to Sway and I said, would it be okay if we had Zaya call in and listen in and get some jewels and get some gems and hear Al's story and be a part of it so he could just learn more and more and more? Al could just kind of school him to everything that's happening here, especially with the connection between him being from Jersey and my nephew with basketball as well, and now interested in this industry as, you know, for the future.
Fire.
I love it.
Me too.
Hey, Zay, what's your question? Why don't you ask Al? Because he's been successful, and I know it wasn't easy, Al, getting permits and licensing and the ability to do this and what it takes to maintain a business, because you got to do a lot of documentation to maintain it legally. Zaya, maybe you could ask him a question. Go for it.
Yeah, I actually have two questions, but first one is, like, for someone who doesn't have the money right now, right, but is looking to get into the industry, you know, later on, you know, I'm looking to get in after college and stuff. What are some things that I should, like, try to get rolling right now when I don't have the money?
The main thing is continue to educate yourself until you're ready, right? You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of information out here about the industry. You know, even, you know, I'm actually going to, you know, start the Harrington Institute in the next 3 months, where we're going to have like a curriculum where we give people like basic training and information into the cannabis space so that, you know, they can also figure out how or what, you know, vertical within cannabis they want to actually work in. Because the thing about it is, like, you know, most people think that when you get in cannabis, it's only growing weed, right? But it's so many other ways that you can impact the industry besides the actual grow. Because I will tell you this, and it's not to discourage anybody, but the biggest risk in cannabis is the cultivation, right? Because those plants are so finicky. They're like, you know, they're like kids, but you know, you have to be very meticulous and different things like that. Well, how you deal with them, because you could lose crops, and it's just a lot of stress. I will tell you that. You know, that's the only thing that every morning when I wake up, where I'm concerned about is like, where's my garden? How is it? How, you know, are the plants happy? What's going on? But, you know, besides that, you know, you have manufacturing licenses, you have retail opportunities, you have testing opportunities. That's one thing that I would say a lot of people don't pay attention to. But can't no cannabis go into any store legally without it being tested? So that's something, that's a vertical that, you know, that everybody has to go through, and that's something I think we need to look at. And then you have like disposal. There's just so many different things that you can do to have an impact in the space. So I think it's just being open-minded. And then also, you know, if you can get internships, and that's one of the other things that we want to start doing as well, but you have to be 21 years old, obviously. But, you know, just getting people in the facilities and just kind of just seeing and learning, because I always say that, you know, especially people of color, right? You know what I'm saying? We're masters of making something out of nothing, and we're so creative, right? So we can just kind of get the exposure to the opportunity. I think that we can figure out ways that we can have an impact.
Oh, man, that's a lot of game, right? Zay, you, it sounds like you're writing that down, Zaya. You're writing that down.
I am right now on my notes right now.
Okay, though. We know we got an on-demand feature, Zaya. You can actually go to SiriusXM.com/on-demand and hear it back. What's your second question? I love the first question.
This one is more like basketball orientated, but so like for when you were in a league or just in high school and all that, when you were training in the off season to try to like get to the next level or just improve your game that way, what were some things that you, in order to get to the next level, you kind of like focused more on?
Well, to be honest, man, like my basketball journey was a lot different than most, right? When I was young, I used to be kind of short and overweight. So, you know, my real name is Albert. So everybody used to call me Fat Albert growing up, right? So I always, you know, I used to play football for the most part because I knew I could just be big and clumsy and just kind of just knock people down. Like, that's what you were supposed to do. But I had a growth spurt going into high school, and when I moved from Orange, New Jersey to Roselle, New Jersey. So when I got to Roselle, everybody thought I was a hooper. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm like, I went from 5'10" as an eighth grader to 6'4" as a freshman. So they kind of threw me into like playing basketball because I was one of the tallest kids in the school, and that's kind of how I started my journey. But what happened for me, honestly, was I fell in love with the game. And, you know, for me, you know, my advice is to work on everything, right? Because you're so young, and, you know, if you love the game, you know, you do your schoolwork, you know, you keep yourself eligible so that you can play, because that's a very important key as well. Because I know a lot of players that I even played with that I feel like, you know, could have definitely took their career a lot further, but they never could get their schoolwork together. So that was something that stopped their, you know, stopped their journey. And when I think about it, it was silly of them, because, you know, schoolwork isn't that hard. And it's just communication, talking to teachers, and just doing your work. You know what I'm saying? You can at least get a C just doing that, even if you don't test well. You know what I'm saying? So number one is just taking care of your schoolwork. But then, you know, you got to live in that gym. And, you know, for me, the things that I did was basically I worked on my handle every single day. I used to shoot 1,000 shots a day. And I just played. And I played with anybody. And the team would like, hello?
Yeah, we could go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, and people laugh at like the way I really got better. Like, I used to play at a Jewish Y in Union, New Jersey. I used to play against like 3-4 like Jewish kids with yarmulkes on their hats, and it'd be like 1-on-4. But it just allowed me to work on my creativity. So I'm saying all that to say, like, you don't have to have the world's greatest trainer. You don't have to have the best gym in the area. it's just really just getting out there and just playing, getting your 10,000 hours. You know what I'm saying? And what they say is anytime you work at anything and you put 10,000 hours into that thing, you become an expert. And I think I got my 10,000 hours through my high school years, and I just continue to just build on that as an NBA, you know, once I got to the NBA.
Wow.
Great question, Zaya. Zaya, hang on the phone, okay, and hear the conversation. Yeah, good to hear your voice,
thank you, man.
Absolutely. Al, he had a growth spurt, too. He used to be a little dude. He got big.
I love it, man. He's an entrepreneur. He got an entrepreneur spirit at a young age. That's amazing. Like, and to your point, like, you know, with the youth being more forward-thinking, that's a pat on our backs, right? You know what I'm saying? Because that's the only way it's going to work for us. You know what I'm saying? We have to take all of our experiences and instill it into our youth, our kids, nephews, nieces, whoever it is, you know what I'm saying, for us to be able to change the history, you know what I'm saying, that we've actually come through.
I wanted to ask you about that change, because I know you've been presently wanting to change the face of CBD and marijuana in the sports industry. We've seen a lot of people who've been demonized or vilified, like a Ricky Williams or different people, J.R. Wright, or different folks, because they partook in, you know, marijuana. And now we have CBD that's entered the fold, and a lot of folks are now starting to use CBD. How do you see marijuana and CBD being useful in professional sports?
Oh, man, it's unbelievably useful. I mean, when you think about it, because it's a natural anti-inflammatory, and, you know, that's what athletes deal with 95% of the time is inflammation, like, in different body parts. So, you know, we always trying to figure out, like, how and what can we use to make ourselves feel better. And, you know, it depends on, you know, which team you're on and what they recommend. But, you know, a lot of times it's anti-inflammatory pills that obviously have harmful effects that have to use, you know, for a long time. And as athletes and first generational wealth within families, a lot of times we make the sacrifice and put our bodies on the line, not only on the court, but off the court and what we put in it, you know what I'm saying, to make sure that we're out there making money and continue to build wealth, you know what I'm saying? So when I think about the correlation of the two, you know what I'm saying, is like I feel like CBD is pretty much a gateway for people to be more open-minded to cannabis, and then eventually they'll get to the THC side of it and then realize that, you know, the entourage effect of CBD and THC is, you know, just a overall better feeling, you know what I'm saying? It's just a better medical option, you know, compared to a lot of the, you know, pharmaceutical drugs and different things that we use, you know, currently. And, you know, I think that as sports continue to, you know, open this up, I think that we will see, you know, and hear more athletes coming out and talking about how, you know, they used to do this and now they do, you know, some type of a cannabis regimen that allows them to go out and, you know, play at a high level. And it also just sets them up for a better quality of life, you know, once they leave the game, because believe me, once we're done, you know, our bodies really, really ache. Uh-huh. And it's just beautiful that now we have an option of using, you know, a natural method, you know, from the cannabis plant compared to, you know, all the, you know, drugs and pills that, and, you know, in the past have always been, you know, recommended.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Trace.
Al, I'm curious. Obviously, with your basketball career, you have to be competitive. And business, you know, you study your competition, you see how to differentiate from your competition. Do you look at competition the same when it comes to this industry? Because you're seeing a lot of fellow athletes, a lot of celebrities stepping into this arena, just your peers in general. And so I wonder if business competition is the same as sports competition?
I would say yes, but I don't think it's as bad. It shouldn't be as bad, you know what I'm saying, especially in this industry, just because it's still so new. You know what I mean? We're still paving the way and we're pioneering the industry, right? So I come from it a little differently mentally, you know what I'm saying? I don't feel like I have no competition in the space, you know what I'm saying? I feel like I'm building my thing. I have different sets of eyeballs that are listening to, you know, our stories and our narrative. And then somebody that's, you know, another company or another athlete, maybe, you know, coming at it from a different way. But I firmly believe, especially athletes and entertainers of color, like, I think that if we're looking at each other as competition, like, we're playing ourselves, because we right now represent less than 4% of the industry. You know what I'm saying? And
right.
If you're really looking at another company, if somebody look like you as competition, Like, I think you're really coming at it the wrong way. You know, my attitude is more of trying to elevate each other. You know what I'm saying? I feel like we could cross promote and just continue to, you know, widen our net and continue, because that's what it's going to come down to. Because if we don't, you know what I'm saying? There's been all these industries, I always say before, like rice, sugar, cotton, lottery, the liquor. Like, right. These were all companies or all industries that we were in. And I think that the reason why we have no representation in those spaces now is because we was in it, but it was very fragmented. And because it's fragmented, it was never an opportunity for us to really put a stake in the ground. And we would ended up either going out of business or being bought up and acquired, and now just sitting on the sidelines and being customers. So I think that, you know, athletes and entertainers should not look at cannabis like this, like that. You know what I'm saying? You know, we are just in the beginning. You know, most people still... You know, most states still don't have any type of cannabis program and different things like that. So I just come from it from a mindset like, hell yeah, of course, I'm very, very competitive. But, you know, if you look like me in this space, you know what I'm saying? I don't view you as competition. You know what I'm saying? I'm more trying to figure out how we can work together to, you know, have a bigger impact.
Beautiful. Mm.
I love that. Al Harrington is here with us. Viola and Replay are his company, celebrating 10 years in business. And when I hear you talk about the percentage of people of color who are in the business, 3-4%, but what percentage of people are behind bars because of the business that are of color? Do you know that number?
I mean, all I can say is, I mean, yeah, it's definitely, I think we're 5 times more likely to be arrested than our counterparts. So you do the numbers on that. But, you know, historically, 85% of all drug arrests for black people and in black communities is cannabis related. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, you just think about just the war on drugs in general. Like, it was really created to enslave us. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what jail to me is a lot of times, how I look at it. You know what I'm saying? So you just think about it, just, you know, in our neighborhoods, you know, I've been out of the hood now for 20 years, thank God, you know what I'm saying, being able to live a better life. But I haven't seen a drug-free school zone sign anywhere where I've lived in the last 20 years. Those things are still in the communities, you know what I'm saying? So I just feel like there's so many mechanisms that they have out there that's continually trying to lock us up. You know, we're still being policed the same way in our communities, you know what I'm saying? So we have a huge issue with that. And, like, that's why, you know, I think the diversity and inclusion is so important, because I really feel like, you know, the cannabis plant can really rejuvenate our community. You know what I'm saying? This is really generational wealth. You know what I'm saying? That risk for us. And we got to, you know, we have to figure out a way to work together so that we could, you know, accomplish that. Because, you know, like I said, just historically, we've seen that it just doesn't happen for us. And I think it's really because of our lack of, you know, working together in, you know, in these situations.
Yo, Al Harrington is with us, man. Whatever you smoking, man, your flow is impeccable today, man. You spitting bars right now, man.
Bars.
What you rolling up right there, Al? What is
right.
that?
Man, I'm smoking. I'm on buckets right now, so I got my own little strain.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense. Okay, I get that. Hey, HB, man, this is one of the good dudes out of Jersey. I like what Jersey's doing right now, Heather. I feel
you
it.
Know what? Would you be one of the good dudes? First of all, you got Redman tonight doing versus.
Right,
so let's talk about that. You know, Tretch, everybody going to be in the building.
Okay.
It's going to be crazy.
Do
what
it all.
What are you talking about, Sway?
I know.
Do it all, dude. Shout out to my brother, Do It All, dude. What'd you say, Al?
It's gonna be epic tonight. I'm rolling with Red Man.
Al,
too. I love meth, but I'm rolling with
let's
Red.
Let's go.
That's some Jersey bias.
Yo,
right
Al,
there.
Next time they all it's a Jersey thing. It is Al. Next time you up this way, man, you gotta come to the house. Me, Sway, Red, Meth, Do It All. We all be here at my house eating and chilling.
All right, well, I mean, I know it's probably too soon, but I'll be there. I'll be there Sunday. This Sunday. I'll be there Sunday
Damn.
To Wednesday.
Okay.
Sundays
well,
be my day, Al.
You know,
Sunday is the cooking day at this
I
house.
I don't want to put you on the spot or nothing, but yeah, let's do it. We can have a nice little session
and
everything.
Sway, would you let him know what day is the day at the house to eat at my house?
Man, hey, yo, man, if you arrive on a Sunday, you ain't going to leave till Thursday.
Oh,
you ain't going to leave, Al. Now, I'm going to be in the Bay this weekend, so I won't be there, man, but leave me something.
No.
Hey, we got a lot of we got a lot of people on the line right now that want to ask you questions. So, to the citizens, if you can, please make the questions quick so we could get to it. I could get to as many people as possible. Chrissy's on the line from the Bay Area. Yee!
Hey, Chrissy.
Yee!
What's up, what's up?
Hey, everybody. Hey, Al. I'm so sorry. I know you want me to be quick, but I just wanted to tell Sway I loved you since KML, okay? They keep coming with that MTV, baby, but I've been there since KML.
There you go, baby. I love you back.
Anyway, good morning, Al. Thank you so much for taking my phone call. I am a 42-year-old woman trying to break into the cannabis space. My biggest issue is financing. I'm also in the middle of a business class that I was awarded through Bank of America to try to get some credentials behind my name and my elevator pitch. I'm trying to figure out how, basically, if you broke, how do you break in? Like, how do I approach investors? How do I approach people who hold already licenses in manufacturing to do partnerships with me? How do I approach crowdsource funding? Should I be giving up equity? How do I protect my idea? It's innovative. It's new. I don't have no competition. My product is not out there.
It's specific
to women. I'm trying to figure out how do I get over the financial hurdle and stay, stay focused and stay positive and not get discouraged, because that's my biggest hurdle. I've been doing my business for 3 years. I sell my product. I got a website. The payment processing has been shut down because I was selling products. I was willing to take that risk because I'm really trying to get my business out there. I believe in it. This is my legacy I'm going to leave behind. Mm-hmm. This is that generational wealth for my kids. I get super emotional when I talk about it because I've been going hard for it for so long. And the financial part is my only hurdle. What can I do?
Well, I think that, continue to build on your business plan. You know, I think that the good thing about it that you got started already, right? So you have a track record. So, I think that a lot of times, in this situation, you will have to give up some equity. But I would say, when you do your first fundraise or your initial friends and family or whatever, make sure you get enough to, give you a 12-month runway. I think that's always the main thing, because obviously over a 12-month span, you can really, really get momentum and obviously really grow something. And then at that point, that's when you can obviously continue to branch off or go on to talk to bigger investors, potentially institutions, different things like that. There's a lot of funding that is coming to the industry. A lot of these MSO companies are, they're trying to do the right thing in regards to, creating, pools of capital to be able to, invest in and fund smaller businesses. Even myself, like, that's why I'm actually coming to New York, because, I'm trying to create this, $100 million to maybe $200 million fund just to invest in social equity businesses, people like yourself, people that have taken the risk, Because, I know at some point of it or some of it is probably gray, but you've been able to create a loyalty fan base, a consumer. So just trying to tap into those people and then obviously be able to, use our resources with this capital, or maybe even, tapping into some of my licenses or different things like that, so we can actually help scale up the business. So I would say the main thing is just keep the business going, keep it afloat, create an unbelievable business plan that you're passionate about, because, that's how I invest in most people. Is like, I see the business plan, different things, but when I can hear and feel the passion and see some form of a track record, it makes me feel more comfortable about investing. And that's what it's all about. You have to just convince investors that, what you're doing is something that is needed in the market. And like you said, the fact that you're doing something that is specifically for women, there's not a lot of brands out there that are catering to women only. They cater to more of the soccer mom, but not, I'm a big opponent against that, because I just think that's just a funny term or whatever. But, I would just say just keep pushing, never give up. And, hopefully, help is on the way, and I think the California just has to do a better job, because all this tax revenue that's being bought in, they should be putting a portion of that aside for social equity to help people from those communities, because they know, and we obviously know because we live it every day, that there's no resources in the neighborhoods. You know what I'm saying? So, New York is one of the states where I give a lot of credit, because New York, most of their program, 40% of all revenue goes back to the communities and go back to incubator programs and giving interest-free loans and different things like that, so people can actually be able to start their businesses.
Wow, that's crazy. That's great information. Might I add, you should follow Al on his Instagram, man. Shoot him a DM or something, right, Al?
Yep, it's at Al Harrington 3.
I will. Sway, thank you. I'm also a fan of Flower. I've been in the professional space for 5 years. I'm a professional bartender, Sacramento's favorite bartender. But I am very familiar with Viola. Are your jars still purple and white? I'm trying to figure out why they're not in my store no more.
Yeah, they're still purple and white, and we're working our way back to the air. We had a setback in 2020, so we kind of had to go back and huddle up and regroup, but we back on the scene. Okay. So, you know, it'll be Flowers on his way back to the bay for sure.
There you go, Chrissy.
Thank you so much. I'm definitely going to reach out. Thank you so much, you guys, for taking my call. It was amazing talking to you.
Yep, good luck. Thank you.
You a citizen, Chrissy.
Thank you.
A sway in the morning.
Thank you. Sway, real quick,
I want to ask Al. Yeah, Al, we mentioned Do It All. Shout out to Do, who's doing so much for the community and Newark, repping for Lords of the Underground. And obviously with Shaq, with his, you know, his history in Jersey and all that he's been able to do in the Newark area, the Essex County area. For you, Al, is Jersey harder? Because you mentioned in New York, but is Jersey harder to break into in terms of the cannabis industry, like to do something in the Newark area? Because downtown Newark is starting to look like downtown Manhattan, you know, it's crazy. Right. So I'm just wondering what it's like for the industry in Jersey.
Well, so, you know, over the last, whatever, 4 years since they've had the cannabis program, obviously it was all medicinal and it was very limited. I think there was only 12 licenses. And, you know, I'm not sure. I don't think anybody of color got any one of those licenses. Mm-mm. So they definitely missed the diversity. You know, they had another round of another 5 licenses, which I applied for. I applied in the southern part of the state in Pensgrove, New Jersey, was like on the borderline of Delaware.
Yeah.
But those licenses got put into a lawsuit because the people from the first round felt that, like, if they was going to extend the program, they should have just extended the winners. So, like, whoever was 1 through 12 won the first 12, and then the next 5 should have been 12 through 17. But the state was like, no, they wanted to open it up to new opportunities. So that's why we apply, and we obviously check that diversity box. And, you know, hopefully we'll have a resolution on those, on that lawsuit and those licenses in the next 60 days is what we're hearing. We'll find out. But obviously we all know, I think in, was it November last year or whatever, you know, cannabis is now legal in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. But now we're just waiting on, you know, the applications and different things like that to see what it will actually take to be able to, you know, one, apply, and then what will be the parameters. Like, you know, will Newark allow 2 stores, 15 stores, you know, all those different things. So until we find out those parameters, you know, I can't speak to that, but, you know, there will be obviously a lot of opportunity in Newark, I would think, because as big as Newark is, they should be anywhere from 10 to 15 stores there. And, obviously I would love to have one there. I'm from there, you know what I'm saying? From that area. But we kind of have to wait and see. But will it be difficult? Yes, it's always difficult. You know what I'm saying? There's no process that's easy, you know, in the cannabis space, I would say, especially when trying to get, you know, a cultivation, manufacturing, or retail licenses.
All right. Hey, we just, Pee Wee in Oregon, I want you to call back. I just saw your line drop. I was just about to take your line. So if you tuned in, Pee Wee in Oregon, call back. I want to go to Art in Ohio. And then, please, let's make the questions quick because Al has to go. He trying to get back to those buckets. We got Art. Al, like, damn, Sway, I'm talking a lot this morning, man. Hey, Art, you got a question?
I got caught in my mouth and everything now, Sway.
Hey, yeah, I just find out too, Al, and I got a little.
Oh, man. You just, wait, say, Art, what'd you say,
my
man?
My question, well, I mean, I said I just put mine out, too, man. I got cotton mouth like a mug, man.
All right, what's your question, Art?
Right quick, Sway, I wanted to remind you, this is the guy who got the tattoo on his arm and winning as a dreamer. I'm still out here winning, Sway.
My man, Art, man. Get that dude a round of applause. Yeah, man. It's good to hear your voice, brother. Good to hear your voice, man.
But I wanted to ask Al, I mean, shouldn't it be more important for us to get into the finance part of it now, too? Because there's a lot of banks who aren't willing to bank with, you know, dispensaries and you know, people who deal with the resource and whatnot, just simply because of the high risk factor. So, I mean, shouldn't we also, you know, look into that? Because I hear a lot of people talking about, I want to go to school for cultivating this and that and the other so they can go to these dispensaries. But I think the financing part, we're leaving too much of that open.
No, I agree with you. I mean, the banking side of it is huge. And I mean, I think they're going to pass the Bank Act at the House, or they did last week, and then there's another vote. So I'm not sure if it's going to go through, but banking is a huge opportunity. I will say, like, when I think about, like, who got rich, like, during this whole prohibition, has been, like, packaging. It's been all the ancillary businesses, the picks and shovels, you know what I'm saying? And I would say banking kind of falls in that lane as well, because I would tell you, like, when I first started, it was all cash. So it was me, duffel bag, walking out, not knowing what's going to happen. You know, my cousin, fearing, scared for him, moving around with all this cash, to finally credit unions started, you know, taking banking. But they was taxing. Like, they was charging us, you know, anywhere from $2,500 to $5,000 per account. Every time we put in anything over $10,000, they would take a percentage. You know what I'm saying? So the banking was so expensive. But, you know, one of the things I always think about is, like, you know, we don't have enough black banks. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not sure what kind of, you know, when you say us, I'm thinking you mean black. But, you know, it's just like, how can we convince our black banks to participate? Because a lot of times, you know, they're scared. You know what I'm saying? Because I've talked to some. But, you know, I invested in this company called Greenwood Bank. I'm not sure if you guys have heard about it. But it's like a
I'm hit bank Greenwood. Or whatever, I did about, the same thing, too.
Go ahead, Al. That big Killer Mike is go ahead.
Yeah, Killer Mike and them. Yeah. So I invested in that bank, you know what I'm saying, this last round of investing. And, you know, that's one of the things that, you know, I'm going to work on with them, is trying to figure out how can we bring the bank into our community. You know what I'm saying? Especially in the cannabis community, because let's keep it within the ecosystem. You know what I'm saying? Like, once again, like, that's where we start to have a real impact, when we can start really supporting each other at different levels. You know what I'm saying? Then banking would be a huge, huge opportunity if we could figure that out.
Hey, I mean, that's one side of that generational wealth that we got to get to, you know.
That's what's up. Hey, Art, we appreciate you, man. Thanks for your call, man. Keep living tattoo, brother. Keep living that tattoo.
Y'all enjoy y'all 420.
Okay. I'm going to take more call, Al, so you can get, you know, liquefy that cotton mouth you got.
Liquefy.
Mike, no, but honestly, man, HB Tracy, what I'm thinking, man, you could teach courses online. I would sign up, brother.
Like,
you give me so much information in 20 minutes, you know, that, you know, it's just, and people aren't giving us much access to all of this information. So I appreciate you sharing like this. We got Mike on the line from St. Louis. Go ahead, Mike.
Hey, Mike.
Yeah, it's good. Hey, everybody, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, I'm at work. First off, I'd like to say good morning, everybody. Sway, Heather B, Tracy G, thank you for everything you did for the culture. Trying to make this quick. Sorry about that. Al, I live in St. Louis. The reason I was calling is I was intrigued about your company you have here. I have a chemistry degree, and I actually always wanted to get into that business and do that. And when you're talking about the lab aspect of it, you're right. A lot of people don't know all the money that can come from just having a lab. Do you have a lab in St. Louis? And if you do, can I talk to you about possibly learning some things or get in contact with you? Because I'm definitely trying to get into this field, because I think it'll make a lot of money. And in the St. Louis area, I would love to try to get that money and get it back to the community, like you were saying. And I would just love to talk with you and just be in cahoots with you if I can. I don't know how to make that work out.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we have a, you know, in St. Louis, we have the building that we was able to secure in the Louis, actually in St. Louis, too. It's 80,000 square feet. You know, we're going to build out 50,000 of it for, you know, cultivation, and then the other 20,000 will be manufacturing. So, yes, there will be a lot of opportunity there. I'd love to talk to you. We never hired a real chemist yet. You know what I'm saying? So that'll be a step up, an upgrade for us. You know what I'm saying? I would love to, you know, obviously talk to you, and, you know, because that's the main thing for us. Like, we want to empower everybody from that community. We're not trying to bring anybody from out of state. We're trying to hire from right there in the loop, or within the Missouri area. You know what I'm saying? Or the St. Louis area. You know what I'm saying? Because that was our biggest thing, and that was the whole thing with Larry, was just like, yo, I love my state. I love my city. I'm just trying to help my people and trying to uplift my people. And, you know, that's why he was the perfect partner. You know what I'm saying? And we're really excited about launching in St. Louis. You know, our stores will be open there in the next probably 60 days. And then, you know, we're building out the cultivation and manufacturing now. So this is the perfect time to meet. And, you know, like you said, you could just hit me on my Instagram. You could just DM me or whatever. And then we could take it from there.
Yeah, Mike, mention
us. Al Harrington 3, correct?
Yep, Al Harrington 3, yep.
And then mention us, Mike.
All right.
All right.
I will. And Heather B, you gotta make this guy do some dishes when he comes over your house. Talking about Sway, he just can't be eating over there all the time.
hey Al, that's the hook. Your man, your brother Sway here. He come over, but he don't be doing no dishes, yo. He don't care.
Yeah. Come on,
he be
Al.
Stuffed like a turkey, I'm sure.
Hey man, you gotta see me, bro. Hey Al, I fall. I get my best naps at Heather's house. Oh my god, man.
She got one of them couches, man.
Bro,
that's all you need.
She got more than one. That's the crazy part, man. There's so many rooms you can sleep in. It's crazy. She got a tall couch too, Al. For you, you know.
Right, a tall couch. I like that. That's funny.
Hey, Michael, you a citizen, brother. Thank you, man. Appreciate
Sway
you.
In the morning.
Hey, man, Al Harrington, this was awesome, bro. We got to stay in contact. I took your number down. I'm going to send you a text just so you can lock me in, okay? And
Yeah, for sure. Hit me.
Absolutely. Congratulations once again on Viola and Replay and continued success. This is a game changer, yes, for our community, and we need people like you as staples in it. And the way you breaking this down, you the truth, bro. You're 10 toes down. You're the truth. So continue success, okay?
Thank you, guys.
Anything you want to say in closing?
Happy 420. Light it up.
Hey! Hey!